speaker for today, and she is the last speaker of VSSP 2021. Onisha Roy, she is a BSc third year mathematics honors student in Jadavpur University, Kolkata. She attended OFCM 2020, a follow-up in 2021, and MTTS level O in 2021. She will be speaking on nested interval theorem. Onisha, are you here?
Hi everyone, today I'm going to talk about the nested interval theorem. So this is a very important theorem in real analysis because you can use it to prove a lot of other theorems or results in real analysis. So let us begin. So this is the plan of my talk. Before introducing the statement of the theorem, I'll give some examples so that everybody gets comfortable with the idea of what we are going to do here. Then I'll give the geometrical representation of the statement of the theorem. I'll try to show the intervals on the number line so that we get an idea again of what we are going to do. And since this is a theorem, we can try to work backwards to figure out if we can find out a strategy for our proof. Then I'll give the proof also. And in the theorem, there are two main conditions that our intervals have to be bounded and they have to be closed. So we'll try to see what happens when we ignore those conditions. So what is the result we're getting? And then we'll try to see that what happens when we add an extra condition. Do we get a more precise result that way? Finally, I'll end by listing some applications of the theorem. So we'll start with by thinking about some examples. So Jn is a notation for interval which are indexed by natural numbers. In our first example, we have our intervals to be closed 0, 1 by n also closed. So let us try to think about what's in its intersection. So let an arbitrary real number C belong to the intersection Jn. And since it belongs in the intersection, it has to belong to all the Jn's, then only it will belong in the intersection. So we get that for all n belonging to n, 0 is less than equal to c, which is less than equal to 1 by n. Using Archimedean property, you can show that c is equal to 0 only. So what we are getting is that our intersection contains only one element, which is 0. And in the second example, our intervals are closed 0, 1 plus 1 by n, also closed. Now let us try to think about their intersection. Let an arbitrary real number x belong to the intersection Jn. So since it belongs in the intersection, it has to belong to all the Jn's, then only it will belong in the intersection. So we get that for all n belonging to n, 0 is less than equal to x, which is less than equal to 1 plus 1 by n. Using Archimedean property, you can show that 0 is less than equal to x, which is less than equal to 1. So in this case, our intersection is not a singleton, it is an interval closed 0, 1. So notice the difference in the two examples that in the first case, we were getting only one element in the intersection. But in the second case, we were not. So later we will try to see that what happens so that we get only one element in the intersection, whether we can say this or not. So let us proceed. This is the statement of the nested interval theorem. It says that let Jn be a sequence of closed and bounded intervals in real numbers such that for all n, Jn plus 1 is a subset of Jn. Or you can say that Jn plus 1 is a subinterval of Jn. Then what are we claiming? Our claim is that the intersection Jn will be non-empty. And we have defined our Jn's to be closed An, Bn, where An is the left-hand point and Bn is the right-hand point. Let us now try to see how the intervals will look like on the real number line. This is an interval J1 where A1 is the left-hand point and B1 is the right-hand point. So can you try to guess how will J2 look like? Remember that our condition was Jn plus 1 has to be contained in Jn. So J2 will be contained in J1. If you continue this process, then you will get that Jn will be contained in that. And further, Jn plus 1 will be contained in Jn. So ultimately, we get a nested sequence of closed and bounded intervals. These three conditions are very important to the theorem, that our we have to get a nested sequence of intervals, and our intervals have to be closed and they have to be bounded. So how do two arbitrary intervals look like? If you take two natural numbers S and R, can we say how will J, S and JR look like? Well, if we can say that, can we give something more? Can we say the order relation among the endpoints of JS and JR? Let us see. So if we take S to be greater than or equal to R, where S and R are natural numbers, then our condition was that JN plus 1 will be contained in JN. So JS will be contained in JS minus 1. And we continue this process till we get JR plus 1, which will be contained in JR. So if we take S to be greater than or equal to R, then JS will be contained in JR. So this is how our intervals will look like on the real number line. This is our interval JS and this is our interval JR. The order relation among the endpoints of the intervals will be that AR will be less than or equal to AS, which will be less than or equal to BS, which will be less than or equal to BR. Now, this is a theorem, so obviously it has to be true. So since it's a theorem, we can afford to do a little cheating here. We can try to work backwards from the claim that we have to see that if we can figure out a strategy for a proof. So what do we need to show ultimately? That our intersection Jn is non-empty. So we might as well show that there's something or some real number belongs in the intersection. And what does it mean to say that some real number belongs in the intersection? It has to belong to all the sets, then only it will belong to their intersection. So let there exist a real number C such that for all n, C belongs to interval Jn. And what does it mean to say that C belongs to interval Jn? An is less than or equal to C, which is less than or equal to Bn. An is the left end point of the interval and Bn is the right end point of the interval. So what if I collect all the left end points of Jn, that is all the An's, and put it in a set and call it E? Then we know that An is less than or equal to C, so C will be an upper bound of E since E contains all the An's, and C is less than or equal to Bn, so the Bn's will also be an upper bounds of E because they are greater than C, which is already an upper bound of E. So we ultimately need to show that such an C exists. So how can we show that? From here only we can try to guess that a smart choice for C seems to be the LUB of the set E, because we are trying to search for the upper bounds, because we are getting the upper bounds of E, then we are trying to find some lower bound for all those upper bounds. So the LUB of E seems to be a good choice for C. So since we have a strategy, let us begin with our proof. We start by constructing a set of the left endpoints, that is all the An's, and we call that set E. And E is non-empty. Why? Because A1 belongs to the set E. And we are claiming that BK is an upper bound of E where you fix K, which is a natural number. So let us see if we can try to show that BK is an upper bound for E. So you fix a natural number K. So what do you think will be the order relation between K and small n, where n is some other natural number? There can be three, right? Because of law of trichotomy. But here we can combine two of those cases in one case because they will eventually be the same thing. So case one is when K is less than or equal to n, and case two is when K is greater than n. So if you remember that what we did with S and R, then when S was greater than or equal to R, we were getting that JS was contained in JR. So when K is less than or equal to N, JN will be contained in JK. So on the number line, this is how our intervals will look like. This is your interval JN, this is your interval JK. If you focus on the last three points, we are getting that AN is less than or equal to BN, which is less than or equal to BK. So we are getting AN is less than or equal to BK. In the second case, when K is greater than N, we are getting that JK will be contained in JN. So this is your interval JK and this is your interval JN. If you focus on the first three points, we are getting that AN is less than or equal to AK, which is less than or equal to BK. So we are getting that an is less than equal to bk. From both the cases, we are getting that an is less than equal to bk. Our k was fixed, but our n was not fixed. And if you remember that the set E contained all the ans, so we have got an upper bound of E, which is bk. And when we were fixing our k, we did not have any restriction on our choice of k, right? So our k was arbitrary. So bk is an upper bound of E for all k. No matter what k you want to choose, it will be an upper bound of E. So now what do we know about this set E? We know that this set E is non-empty. We know that it is bounded above and the upper bounds are the bks. So by the LUB axiom of real numbers, E is LUB and we call that LUB to be C. So what do we know about this C now? C is the LUB of E. Since it is the LUB of E, it will also be an upper bound of E. And what does it mean to say that C is an upper bound of E? We say that for all an in E, an is less than or equal to C. Remember that we also found that bns were upper bounds of E and C is the least among all the upper bounds. So what is the relation between LUB of the set and any other upper bound? It will be that LUB is less than or equal to an upper bound. So C is less than or equal to bn. If you combine these two inequalities, we are getting that an is less than or equal to C, which is less than or equal to bn. So this means that C belongs to interval jn because an was the left end point and bn was the right end point. And this happens for all n. So since this happens for all n, this also goes inside the intersection. So we are done with the proof. We can now say that our intersection is non-empty. But when we were working backwards, you might have had a question that why did we only collect the left end points of Jn? Why can we not collect the right end points? So you can do that. It's not a hard and fast rule. You can collect all the right end points of Jn, but then you would have to go searching for lower bounds of the set and you would eventually get the greatest lower bound of the set and you can proceed with the proof from there. So now that we have seen the statement of the theorem, we have seen how they look like on the number line. We have also seen a proof. So we are pretty convinced that the theorem is true. So now we want to see what happens if we want to ignore one of the conditions in the theorem. Remember that our theorem had three main conditions, that we have to get a nested sequence of intervals, our intervals have to be bounded and they have to be closed. But what if I want to ignore that condition of boundedness? What is going to happen then? So let us see. When we take our intervals to be closed n, infinity, which is open, obviously. So if you try to plot it on the number line, you'll be able to see that jn plus 1 is contained in jn. So that condition is satisfied. And these intervals are closed because the infimum and supremum belong in the sets, but they're not bounded because they're not bounded above because infinity is written here. So let us try to think about its intersection. Let X be an arbitrary real number which belongs in the intersection Jn. So since it belongs in the intersection, it has to belong to all the sets, then only it will belong in the intersection. So for all n in n, X is greater than or equal to n. But this statement seems to say that we have found a upper bound for natural numbers, which is absurd because Archimedean property says that natural numbers are not bounded above. So we were wrong and our intersection is now empty. So you cannot just ignore the condition of boundedness if you want to do so. The theorem will fail then. So we want to see the same thing. We want to experiment and see the same, whether we can do the same thing with the property of the intervals being closed. Can we also ignore that condition? And what happens when we do choose to ignore that condition? So let us take our intervals to be open 0, 1 by n. And let us try to think about its intersection. So if you see them on the number line, you will be able to see that jn plus 1 is contained in jn and our intervals are bounded because they're bounded below by 0 and they're bounded above by 1. But they're not closed. Why? Because 0 does not belong to the interval. So let us now try to think about its intersection. let X be an arbitrary real number which belongs in the intersection Jn. And since it belongs in the intersection, it has to belong to all the Jns, then only it will belong in the intersection. So for all n in n natural numbers, 0 is strictly less than x, which is strictly less than 1 by n. So the x will be positive because it is greater than 0, and n will be obviously positive because it's a natural number. So we are getting that n is less than 1 by x. But again, we are getting the same thing, that natural numbers are bounded above, which cannot happen because it contradicts Archimedean property. So our intersection is empty because our assumption was wrong. So now we are convinced that all the conditions in the theorem are pretty important. They're equally important, that our intervals have to be nested, they have to be bounded, and they have to be closed. So now we can take it one step ahead and see what happens when we want to add an extra condition. Can we get a more precise result if we add an extra condition? So the extra condition that we want to add is that we want to make the length of our intervals very small. And what does it mean to say that something is very small in mathematical terms, that it tends to zero? And here our Jn is a sequence, so you can even say that it converges to zero. So if we can make the length of our intervals very small, then what are we claiming? We are claiming that the intersection Jn is a singleton. It will contain only one point. So we start by assuming that the length of our intervals tend to zero. And we assume that C and D are two real numbers which belong in the intersection Jn. We are taking C and D distinct. So we can try to, one of the ways we can prove something is by contradiction. So we can try to see if we can get a contradiction somewhere, since we are taking C and D to be distinct real numbers. So let C and D be two real numbers belonging in the intersection Jn. And since they belong in the intersection, they will belong to all the Jns, then only they will belong in the intersection. So this is your interval Jn, and these are your points C and D on the number line. So clearly the distance between C and D is mod C minus D will be less than equal to the length of the interval, which is mod Bn minus An. Because if it was greater, then at least one of the points would be out of the interval. Then they would be out of the intersection also. But we don't want that, do we? So what have we assumed? That the length of our intervals tend to zero. And what does it mean? Jn is a sequence here. So what does it mean to say that something converges to zero? We say that you give me an epsilon and we'll be able to find a natural number such that for all n greater than n naught, mod Bn minus An is less than epsilon. Remember that mod C minus D was less than equal to mod Bn minus A, which is now less than the epsilon that you have given. So mod C minus D will be even less than epsilon. And something in mod cannot be negative. So you have only one choice. By Archimedean property, you can show that it is zero. So we are getting C is equal to D, and we are getting only one point in the intersection. Now, if you can recall the very first two examples that we did, if you try to think about it, in both the examples, the three conditions of the intervals being nested, they bounded and closed, have to be there. On top of that, in the first case, the length of our interval was 1 by n minus 0, which was 1 by n, and it tends to 0. That is why we got only one single point in the intersection. But in the second case, the length of our intervals was 1 plus 1 by n, which was not tending to 0, it was tending to 1. That is why we did not get a single point in the intersection. So this is just an observation. So I'll end by listing some applications of nested interval theorem. So since this is a theorem, so like I said, that it is a very important tool because we can use it to prove a lot of other results and theorems. So here are some of the applications. You can prove that the set of real numbers is uncountable. You can also prove Bolzano-Weierstrass theorem for sets and sequences. Here I have written the sequence version. It says that a bounded sequence of real numbers has a convergent subsequence. You can also prove intermediate value theorem, which says that let f be a continuous function from closed AB to real numbers. And if a and fb are of different signs, then there exists a c in open AB such that f of c is zero. You can also prove that rational numbers are dense in R. Obviously, there are other methods to prove it, but you can use nested interval theorem to prove it. I won't be going into the proofs. So these are my references for this presentation. I have referred to this video lecture by Kumaresan sir. And if you are interested in any of the proofs or knowing more applications of nested interval theorem, then you can go to this expository article by Kumaresan sir also. So this is the end of my talk. Thank you for listening.
Thanks, Anisha, for the excellent talk.